We study toys in our center because they are a fundamental part of children's play, which is so important for development. Toys, in a way, are a research tool that allow us to kind of peer into children's young, developing brains to see what's going on in there. We can use them as researchers to look at early growth and development.
For the past 10 years, we've been conducting the TIMPANI Toy Study, toys that inspire mindful play and nurture the imagination. This year, we selected 10 toys that represent the broad array of different types of play materials you find in a preschool classroom. So we had construction play toys, replica play toys, toys with loose parts, water play toys, music play, and pretend play toys. And then we had three students carry out the work of videotaping and coding footage of children playing with those toys.
Every 2 weeks, teachers would get a toy. There were a total of 10 toys, and they rotated through each of the four classrooms. And once a week, we would record children playing with the toy. After collecting that footage, we would code it. We were using an instrument that looks at the impact toys have on children's play.
So there's four different categories. We score them from 1 to 5, 5 being the highest rate of play and 1 being the lowest. And we score their highest moments of play within that 5-minute block, and you're only watching one child at a time.
We have codes for each and every child in the room that plays with the toy. We try to see the results, like which toy scores the most among those four broad categories.
For thinking and learning, we were mostly looking at children's thought processes with the toys.
The kind of play they are doing with the toys, how it is helping them to think about it.
How they explored the toy, was there problem solving? Did they, you know, really try to figure it out? Were they asking questions?
The high scoring toy in thinking and learning is the waffleblocks.
Waffleblocks are these square pieces. They look like waffles, but some of the pieces are curved. There were some that were triangular.
They interlock, so they're almost like a puzzle piece because the pieces connect within each other, and then they could connect front to back.
I thought it was remarkable for their engineering skills.
I think one of the challenges children had was figuring out how to put them together.
I have a window.
They kept trying to problem solve and build on one another's. And so I think like their brain was just constantly going and just trying to figure out everything that they could make with it. And because it was so open-ended, that the learning really just never stopped.
And then it closes if the monster tries to bite the frog.
For creativity and imagination, we were looking at the different ways children use the toy. So if they were using it for its intended purpose, or if they were using it in a more novel or unique way.
How a child can transform a toy into a completely different thing.
We also looked at if they created a play narrative.
Play narratives are like stories that children create. These are imaginary scenarios that they carry out in a make-believe world.
We had a tie in this category.
One of the highest scoring toys in creativity and imagination was the family counters.
So the family counters are miniature people. They have like adults and babies, and then there are cats, so it resembles a family.
I'm the daddy. Look at me. The three kitties.
Sometimes they color-coded them. Sometimes, you know, they grouped them by the type that it was or the size of it. You could almost look at them like math manipulatives.
I got two kitties. Two blue kitties. I have 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 6 orange. I got 6 yellows.
A lot of times children use these to carry out family play narratives. That was what I saw the most with this toy.
I got to school now. Okay, come on, babies. It's time to go to the toddler school.
That's what they see in their homes, in their families.
Okay, have a good day, baby. We get to your new teacher.
They were collaborating. They were working together to put on this more elaborate play narrative.
The other highest scoring toy was the waffle blocks.
I think waffle blocks did well because children did transform it. They used it to create things that didn't necessarily resemble the block itself. They created structures resembling towers or houses. I think that when children transformed the waffle blocks, that was when they were most engaged.
What's that? If the monster coming, it closes, so the monster will escape. But you still have to have a pickaxe.
You know, so it was just amazing to see where their mind took them with those. It was so open-ended, and they had that ability to just make anything with it. There really was no expectation.
So for social interaction, we were looking for how they interact with their peers when playing with the toy.
Were they parallel to a peer? Was it associative play? Was it cooperative? Were they working together to play the same thing?
If their interactions with their peers are positive or if conflicts arise when they're playing with the toy.
The high-scoring toy in the social interaction is the puppet theater.
So the puppet theater itself is really unique because it's not just puppets. The theater is really what stole the show.
Amelia, we need it up and we're having a show.
Children, they love to roll up the curtains and roll it down again.
In the backdrop, you could reverse, so there were different scenes on both sides.
I found often they were exploring the puppet theater together. I think it's backwards, or I think this goes up. And within that, I think we saw the highest levels of just cooperation.
We have to go over there to watch. What? We have to go over here to watch.
I think puppet theater did so well in social interaction because a lot of time they were working collaboratively to kind of set up this puppet show and then also perform it.
Guys, the puppet show is starting.
They would do the puppet show and a couple of them would pretend to be the audience.
It's a sunny day.
So for verbalization, we were looking at any utterances children make while using the toy, making noise or talking.
It's sound effects. It's, you know, making noises and singing. Were they able to have conversations with their peers? Did the conversations last?
One of the highest scoring toys in the area of verbalization was the family counters.
There were a lot of play narratives that came along with family counters, so in order to convey those play narratives, they needed to verbalize.
Now it's time to go, girls. Come on, baby, come on.
Children role-played with all those miniature figures. They came up with scenarios they see around them in their homes and environment.
It does replicate something that they've had past experiences with.
We're almost there. It's time to go.
They have that knowledge that they were really able to, like, expand on it and vocalize what they were thinking.
Hello, I'm here to get my babies. No, you can't get your babies. They're running.
The other high-scoring toy was the puppet theater.
What should we do today? Maybe.
When they were putting up the puppet show, there were a lot of verbalization.
If we don't have the background on, then we won't have the show.
They had a theme for the show that made provisions for a lot of verbalization.
We can do the mommy language back. And I'm this baby.
So with them putting on the show, they're not only talking to each other about what they need to do, but also talking in order to put on the show and convey their ideas to their audience.
And I bite, and I bite.
The highest scoring toy across all areas were the family counters. They used these toys as replica play toys, that is, tiny plastic people they could use to carry out all kinds of different scenarios.
This is my good sister, Blue. I'm not your good sister anymore. I'm his good sister.
You get everyone in there, like as you see in your family. You could have a grandma, you could have a grandpa, and then brothers, sisters, pets.
And here's my new dad. And where's the new mom? Here's the new mom.
It so much relates to their family surroundings. I believe that's why it was scoring over and over in some of those categories.
Like I got two babies, one on my arm and one on my head.
What makes these toys so valuable is they're simple and nondescript. They don't have a lot of detail to them, and that allows children to play with them in almost any way they wish. Children need to discuss with peers who a particular figure represents or what they're doing.
Bad guy baby. No, he's a good baby. No, he's a bad guy baby.
Okay,
the red ones are the bad guys.
There's not really one intended purpose, so in addition to the play narratives, a lot of times children would line them up or they would stack them on top of each other. So it really leads to possibilities for making patterns or for counting.
Now how many kids do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's gonna be a lot.
The Family Counters was the highest scoring toy for girls and the second highest scoring toy for boys. It also ended up being the most popular toy this year. It was played with more frequently than any other toy.
I would say that our findings this year are pretty consistent with those of other years. Toys that are simple, non-realistic, that include a variety of different parts, have a remarkable impact on children's play.
In addition, we've seen that some toys do really well in some categories of learning, and other toys do well in other categories. So it's important for teachers to be really intentional about the play materials they're bringing into their classroom and what it is that they're hoping children are getting out of those materials.
You can't just have one type of toy and expect it to elicit good thinking and learning and also social interaction. You have to put it in your classroom first and kind of observe children's play and then take what you observed and kind of think about it, evaluate it, and consider how it could affect their play.
For me, I would certainly focus on how children verbalize, how they're thinking and learning when they play with these toys.
Observing is just so powerful, and you know, it's like every day you learn something new. Every student has different experiences, and you know, their excitement might not be what yours is, and I just think that's really important to remember moving forward.
A key lesson from over the years is how important it is to regularly review and reflect on how children are playing with toys, and to ensure that there's a variety of open-ended materials in the classroom to meet the needs of all learners.
The end.